next week, we have confirmation, which will be at this service, the 8:30 room. So come for that. These young men and young women, Professor Owens, doctor. On Thursday, that means Thursday of this coming week, 5 days from now, we will have the catechism questioning, which will take place right here in the sanctuary as usual, with social distancing, as they call it, all of that. And then the week after that, so that's June 28th, and the week after that, we will change the morning service schedule a little bit. Instead of 8:30 to 10:30, we will go to 8 and 10:30. That will allow us to have a 40 or 45 minute Bible study in between in the fellowship hall and all that. We're still talking about how we might be starting a new Sunday school with that maybe a week later or so. I think that's it for scheduling. We'll bring that then we'll return to our Lord service.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved of the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And He forgave me of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I am a poor miserable sinner. The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday after Pentecost is from Jeremiah chapter 20. O Lord, you have deceived me, and I was deceived. You're stronger than I, and you have prevailed. I've become a laughingstock all the day. Everyone mocks me. For whenever I speak, I cry out, I shout, violence and destruction. For the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and derision all day long. If I say I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, there is in my heart, as it were, a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I'm weary with holding it in, and I cannot. For I hear many whispering, terror is on every side. Denounce him, let us denounce him, say all my close friends watching for my fall. Perhaps he will be deceived, then we can overcome him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me. persecutors will stumble. They will not overcome me. They will be greatly ashamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, who tests the righteous, who sees the heart and the mind, let me see your vengeance upon them, for to you have I committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hand of evildoers. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Romans chapter 6. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Are we to sin because we're not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you're slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you are committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were freed in regard to righteousness. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God. The fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter.
Glory be to the
Lord. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It's enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house of Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light. And when you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to
the
Lord.
I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth.
said, "Do not fear those who kill the body and cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them fall to the ground apart from your Father? But even the hairs of your head are numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows." In the name of Jesus. Jesus tells you who you should fear. And when he does, it is pure gift. Jesus said, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." It would be true that usually when we think of fear, we don't think of gift. Anxiety, sleepless nights, terror, sweaty palms, troubled conscience, distress, nerves, that's what we think of with fear. But Jesus tells you who to fear, and it is a gift. Fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. The only one who can throw you, body and soul, into hell is Jesus. No earthly army can throw into hell. An army can kill your body, but cannot cast into hell. No loss of friends, loss of job, no attack by any other can throw you into hell. Satan cannot cast you into hell. He, like you, is a creature, and he does not have power over eternal life. Only Jesus can throw you into hell. Which means, do not fear the army with weapons. Do not fear the attack of enemies. Do not fear loss of wealth or income. Do not fear any earthly onslaught. Do not fear Satan and the demons. Fear only Jesus. But when you fear only Jesus, you look at Jesus and you see in his hands the print of the nails, and you know it was for you. It was for you that his body took the piercing of the sword, the insult and spitting of the soldiers. It was for you that he spilled his blood, even unto death. Fear only Jesus, and then hear his words, "Fear not." The only one you should fear is the one who says to you, "Fear not. Fear not your sin, I have taken it away. Your shame, I have covered you with my own honor. Your anxiety, your sleepless nights, your terror and sweaty palms, your troubled conscience, your distress, your nerves, do not fear. I have taken all of it upon myself. I have redeemed you with my blood. I have cleansed you and made you mine. You have nothing to fear." So it's a joyful life that Jesus gives, a blessed life, a life of hope and grace. What could make this go wrong? What could rob you of this joy? The way to rob a Christian of joy is to put the Christian under the law. The law is God's word to show guilt, God's word always accusing. The law is God's word echoing in our conscience, his word from which we want to run, his word used by the devil to bring our sins up in front of our face and to cause us to tremble. Do not fear the devil, though. He cannot throw you into hell. Fear only Jesus, the one with nail prints in his hands for you, the one saying to you, "Fear not." But if you do want to rob yourself of this joy, it is easy. Return to the law. Leave behind the gospel. Return to the law so that you can try to deal with your own sin by keeping the law, so that you can try to find your honor by making yourself righteous with the law, so that you can try to justify yourself by sorting yourself out by the law. Leave the gospel behind and return to the law, and then you will know fear. The fear of trying to make yourself holy, but being unable. Of hearing the demons accuse you and keep you in guilt. Of having the word of law stinging your conscience. Of the anxiety and the stress belonging to one who fears any Jesus, who alone can cast you into hell. Sin has no dominion over you, says Paul, since you are not under the law, but under grace. Romans 6:14. Sin brings the fear and the distress. Sin is made manifest. That is, the guilt of our sin is thrown in our face by the law. This has no dominion over you, says Paul. The law has no dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. By the law, you will never deliver yourself from sin or death or fear. You will only drive deeper into it. What delivers you from sin and death and fear? Jesus. Grace. Sins forgiven. The word of the cross cleansing your conscience. The name of Jesus put on you in baptism. The body and blood making you holy. This, Jesus and his gifts, delivers from all fear. You are not under the law, says Paul. You are under grace. You are not under the accusing word the demons bring to your conscience. You are under the word of justification, giving you a good conscience at peace with God. You are not paying the wages of sin, which is death. Jesus paid that wage by the price of his own blood on the cross. You are receiving the free gift of God, which is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 6:23. Then what is the law to you? It is still the word of God which we are to hear. It is still the accusation which we must hear every day as long as we're still in our life of flesh. It is still the word of God accusing us so that constantly we are brought to repentance and the old Adam of sin is daily put to death in that repentance. And it is still the word by which we know, even while we're still in our sinful flesh, that we should love our neighbor as ourselves. We should obey the government authorities for the good of society and the benefit of our neighbor. And we should know our guilt when we do not do these things of God's law. But the law is not the word by which we are righteous, not the word by which we'll ever bring life to ourselves or be delivered from fear. The gospel, the word of grace, the word of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, you are under that word. The gospel brings no fear, only forgiveness and grace. The gospel does not cast into hell. It brings the gift of life. You are under the gospel. It is your life of faith. It is your life of knowing that Jesus is the only one who can cast into hell, and he is the one with nail prints in his hands for you. Matthew 10:28. Jesus said, "Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore. You are more valuable than many sparrows." In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. For the churches of the Apostolic Creeds and the Augsburg Confession throughout the world, that God would keep them steadfast in his word and unified in the confession of his name, and that he would bless those seeking fellowship, that where there is unity of doctrine, there may also be oneness in fellowship. Let us pray to the Lord. For all pastors in Christ, that though persecution is to be expected, God will use their preaching to soften the hardened hearts of unbelievers. Let all pastors remain ever faithful to the gospel and give them boldness that comes from the confidence that they can depend upon his protection. Especially be with those pastors given to serve the church throughout the world in dangerous and persecuted places. For all these, let us pray to the Lord. For all who are given positions of authority in our nation, our state, and our community, that God would grant them clarity of mind, selflessness, and wisdom in decision-making, that they would wield the sword of justice rightly, to protect the innocent and the weak, and to bring justice to those who do evil. And that all given authority would uphold the divine institutions of marriage and family, of house and home and property. Let us pray to the Lord. For those with afflictions of both body and soul, that God would look with favor upon all who are sick, hospitalized, or grieving, especially Audra, McKenna, Shannon, Scott, John, Karen, Armella, Janice, Opal, Sonia, Laura, Dante, Jim, Robert, June, Jess, Sandra, Ray, Pearl, Barrett, Ann, and Jeff. So that as not one of the sparrows falls to the ground apart from God, so much more are we to know that God values his children, knows their every affliction, and graciously cares for them. For all those who are sick or hospitalized, let us pray to the Lord. For those who are marginalized in our society, especially the unborn, the weak, and the vulnerable, that God, who knows the number of hairs on their heads, would keep us mindful of our duty to speak up for those with no voice, and that he would bless every effort to uphold life from conception to natural death. Let us pray to the Lord. For our congregations and families, for all families, especially on this national holiday celebrating fathers, and for all mothers with child, that they would have much joy in their pregnancy, and that both mother and child would be protected. And for all of our members who served in the armed forces, including Jesse, Ian, Jacob, Jake, Colin, Bill, Tyler, Cale, Christopher, Michael, Dave, Wesley, Peyton, and Elliot, that we would all, as the Lord's family, hear your word, build each other up in the gospel, and be strengthened as members of the body of Christ, and that we would have much delight in being given to bring our gifts in service to one another and to the church. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who receive the Lord's Supper this day, that God may set their hearts and minds to those things which are good, right, and salutary, and that having been set free from sin, they may become slaves to God, rejoicing in the free gift of God, eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. Into your hand, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who, having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul unto life everlasting. Amen. God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh. We thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bless me the Lord.